And now onto our dinosaur of the day, Lambeosaurus, which was a request from Cole via Patreon and Dinosaur4602 via YouTube, so thanks. It was a hadrosaurid that lived in the Late Cretaceous in what is now North America, and the name means lamb's lizard. It's named in honor of Lawrence Lambe. It was described in 1923 by William Parks, but Lawrence Lambe actually spent 20 years studying the first material. Multiple species have been named, from Alberta, Canada, Montana, US, and Baja California, Mexico, but now only two Canadian species are considered valid. As you might expect, it does have a long history, as many of the dinosaurs who were named early on do.
Yep.
At one point, there were seven species of Lambeosaurus. Some of them have been determined to be different sexes of already named Hadrosaurid genera.
Weird. I'm skeptical.
Anyway, Lawrence Lambe described the first Lambeosaurus fossils in 1902, the postcranial skeletons with no skull. But he assigned them to Trachodon marginatus, but Trachodon is now a dubious genus. Then in 1914, he described two new skulls that he thought should be Trachodon marginatus, but since Trachodon was dubious, he created a new genus, Stephanosaurus. The skulls came from around the same area as the Trachodon marginatus fossils, so it means they could have all been the same type of dinosaur, but it's not for certain. Because of this, in 1923, William Parks re-described the Stephanosaurus skulls as Lambeosaurus and named them in honor of Lawrence Lambe, who had died in 1919. A number of fossils that were originally classified as other dinosaurs have now been determined to be Lambeosaurus. In 1902, Henry Fairfield Osborne named Didanodon altidens based on a partial left jaw, and Lawrence Lambe reclassified it as Trachodon altidens. In 1917, Lawrence Lambe named a new dinosaur Chineosaurus, which became the type genus of the group Chineosaurinae, a group of dinosaurs that looked like hadrosaurs but were smaller. In 1920, William Diller Matthew named a new dinosaur Prochineosaurus based on a photograph of a skeleton. Later, William Parks described Tetragonosaurus from fossils found in Dinosaur Park Formation and included fossils from Prochineosaurus into the type species Tetragonosaurus praeceps. Two other species were added to Tetragonosaurus, Erectophrons and Cranibrevis. Then in 1942, Richard Swan Lull and Nelda Wright did a study about all of these dinosaurs and said that all Tetragonosaurus should be Prochineosaurus and that Trachodon altidens could also be Tetragonosaurus. Lull got approval from the ICZN to use the name Tetragonosaurus instead of Prochineosaurus.
And the ICZN is the International Commission on Zoological Nomenclature, which is the body that basically says whether or not things are named correctly.
It's always interesting to me when they say, yes, this name can be the official name even when it was named after. But anyway. Charles Marsh named a genus Hadrosaurus possidens based on a partial maxilla and squamosal from the Judith River Formation in Montana. But in 1964, John Ostrom said that that was probably a Lambeosaurus. Only postcranial remains, so no skull, have been found of Lambeosaurus possidens, so it's not clear if it is actually Lambeosaurus. In 1975, Peter Dodson found that Chineosaurinae, which included Prochineosaurus, were actually juveniles of larger hadrosaurs, and that the type specimen of Prochineosaurus was actually a juvenile Lambeosaurus, and the others were juvenile Corythosaurus. He found this by measuring dozens of skulls and interpreted the differences as being juvenile or male or female. Interestingly, Prochineosaurus was named before Lambeosaurus, and usually the older name is the one that sticks, but not in this case.
Yeah, sometimes that has to do with having not enough remains or not describing it perfectly.
Mm-hmm. Bill Morris named Lambeosaurus laticatus with a question mark in the 1970s, and these were Lambeosaurine remains in Baja California, but no complete crest was found, so it's not known for sure if it's a Lambeosaurus. He based it on the parts of the skull that were found. In 2012, it was assigned to a new genus, Magnipolia. So now, that leaves us with two valid species, Lambeosaurus lambei, the type species, and Lambeosaurus magnicristatus. Lambeosaurus lambei and Lambeosaurus magnicristatus were from the Dinosaur Park Formation, though they lived at slightly different times. They're part of the family Lambeosaurine, the subfamily of hadrosaurids with hollow crests. They're closely related to Corythosaurus, Hippocrosaurus, and Alorotitan. They're all very similar, but they have slightly different crests. The Lambeosaurus crest was shifted forward, and hollow nasal passages were in the front of the crest and stacked vertically. The crest is also a little bit different in each species of Lambeosaurus. Lambeosaurus lambei had a crest that was hatchet-like in shape in adults, and shorter and more rounded in specimens thought to be females. This hatchet blade is in the front of the eyes, and they had two sections. There's an upper portion of a thin, bony coxcomb that developed right before adulthood, and a lower portion that had hollow spaces that were part of the nasal passages. They also had a handle, quote-unquote, that was a solid, bony rod that went over the back of the skull. In Lambeosaurus magnicristatus, this handle was smaller and the blade was larger, though this crest is damaged in the most complete specimen, so only the front half is left. There's a few theories about what this crest was used for. One is that it was like a snorkel or air chamber, so Lambeosaurus could keep its head underwater for long periods of time, but that would mean it was often in water and doesn't explain why Lambeosaurus crests look different from other Lambeosaurines. Another is that it stored salt glands, but salt glands are usually in animals that live in saltwater ecosystems, though areas where Lambeosaurus had been found were near the western interior sea, which was saltwater. And in 1979, Jack Horner described what looks like a Lambeosaurus magnicristatus jaw from marine sediment, but this doesn't explain why other hadrosaurs were in different ecosystems, not just saltwater, and it doesn't explain why the crest looks different between the Lambeosaurus species.
Those are some pretty far out there theories. The snorkel one is just wackadoo.
That was one of the first.
Yeah, that sounds like, it reminds me of the sauropods where it's like they needed long necks so they could stand on the bottom of the lake and get their head out of the water.
Another theory is that the crests were used for display so that they could tell their species apart and as a sign of maturity, since adults had more developed crests. Also, specimens scientists think are females have more rounded crests than males.
That always seems like circular logic to me, though, because they're arguing that they are females based on the shape of the crests, and then they point out, like, oh, look at these differences in the crests. We have these two groups, but they could just be different species.
Could be.
Because with birds, you see that kind of thing all the time, like a slight difference in coloration and they're different species.
Yeah. I don't know what other factors make them think they're females versus males.
Yeah, that's true.
Probably most popular theory now, though, is that the crest may have been used to create sounds.
Yeah, that's a cool one.
Yeah.
And we've even seen a recreation of the sound of Parasaurolophus based on the shape and size of its nasal cavity.
Yeah.
Although there could have been soft tissue in there, so it's a little guessy.
It's always guessy.
Yeah, that's true.
So Dodson suggested that Lambeosaurus had sexual dimorphism based on their crests. However, David Evans and Robert Rees re-examined the skulls Dodson had looked at and suggested that it was too small of a sample size and there was an incomplete fossil for Lambeosaurus magnicristatus.
Right on.
So Dodson had looked at only two individuals of Lambeosaurus magnicristatus, and he found that one of them had a larger crest and then based on that suggested there was sexual dimorphism. But as I said, one of those crests was damaged.
Mm-hmm.
Which is what Evans and Rees found, was that the female crest was broken, and that's the only reason it seems smaller, and if it weren't broken, they would have looked the same. So there you go, Garrett.
Yeah, statistical power for sexual dimorphism is really hard to get, and I think there was actually a talk, I believe at last year's SVP, where they pointed out that we don't have enough samples of any dinosaur to see sexual dimorphism, and that includes things that we find a ton of, like some of the hadrosaurs where we have like 50 or 60 samples. Mm-hmm. We still can't tell.
So there's other paleontologists, such as James Hobson, who suggested that Lambeosaurus lambei were females and Lambeosaurus magnicristatus were males, but these species were not found at the same stratigraphic level. Lambeosaurus was both bipedal and quadrupedal. It had four digits on each hand, and the second, third, and fourth digits were together and bore hooves so they could go on all fours for support if they wanted.
That's the craziest thing to me, those hands that are like also hooved.
Mm-hmm. Multi-use.
Yeah.
So the last digit on the hand was free, and that could be used to help with grip or balance. That's the crazy thing to me.
It's like a thumb, sort of, with hooved fingers.
They had three digits on each foot. Because it was both bipedal and quadrupedal, Lambeosaurus could eat low to moderately high growing vegetation. It had a narrow front of the mouth, which may mean it was a picky eater. It also had batteries at the back of the mouth with over 100 teeth to grind plant matter. Lambeosaurus is about 31 feet or 9.4 meters long. Some scale impressions have been found. They found these polygonal scutes on the neck, torso, and tail on Lambeosaurus lambei, and on the neck, forelimb, and foot on Lambeosaurus magnicristatus. Lambeosaurus had a long, stiff tail with ossified tendons and large eye sockets and sclerotic rings, which means it probably had good vision and was diurnal. It also had a strong sense of hearing. This is based on Corythosaurus, a close relative, having slender stapes, which are reptilian ear bones, and large space for an eardrum. Lambeosaurus lived near rivers and floodplains with wet and dry seasons, and other animals that lived around the same time and place include Corythosaurus, though Corythosaurus may have lived earlier than Lambeosaurus, and Lambeosaurus actually may have even replaced Corythosaurus. But other animals included Chasmosaurus and Centrosaurus, ceratopsians.
The OG ceratopsians that named the two groups.
Edmontonia, a notosaur. Euoplocephalus, an ankylosaur, as well as the tyrannosaurs, albertosaurus, and displetosaurus. Quite the variety.
Yeah, and some well-known guys, too.
Mm-hmm.